I do apologize for the clickbait title, but it is not clickbait, so I guess I'm gonna take my apology back. In this video I talked about additive and subtractive color mixing, and just a recap, let's say you have two colors, one of them is already on the paper and the other one is still on your brush. These are called the source and destination colors, which sound confusing but they do make sense. Now, you paint with your brush. The way that these two colors mix is called the blend mode. Of course, I'm talking about digital colors with RGB values and whatnot. The blend mode is basically the calculation that you do when putting a new color on your screen. It's quite simple really, it looks something like... Oh, wow, that's let's simplify that. Hopefully that's better. So what that does is, it calculates the next color using the color on the screen, the destination color, and the color on your brush, the source color. The part that we control are these factors. The normal blend mode is something like this. Multiply the destination by 0 and multiply the source by 1. Here's how it works in practice. This red square is already on the screen and you want to draw this blue square on top. You multiply the destination color by 0, which means it's black, and then you add the source color. But you might ask, what if this color is transparent? Well, I wish you wouldn't ask that because it gets really confusing. But if I can understand it, then so can you. First, along with the RGB values, these colors also have a 4th channel called alpha, which represents their opaqueness. But these are usually calculated separately. Basically, we have to multiply the source color by its transparency or alpha value and multiply the destination by the inverse of the source's alpha value. Why? Well, in this case, the alpha value essentially determines how dominant the color is. I wonder if that's why it's called alpha. Multiplying the source by its alpha gives us how strong the new color is, and multiplying the destination by its inverse gives us the rest. We generally don't have to worry about the color below being transparent because that was already calculated. It was also a source color in its use. Something like this is usually how glass is rendered in games. And this sort of transparency lets us see right through the lies told us by games using blend modes. So far we talked about the normal blend mode. Huh. But why don't we lighten the mood a bit, huh? Get it? Lighten? Well, you shouldn't, because I made the pun before I mentioned the topic. But the topic is light. Okay, here's an example. These two images have a very basic light on them, and you can hopefully see that this one looks better or at least more realistic. This can be achieved by additive blending. Actually, it's the same in real life. That's because when light hits a surface, it doesn't become the color of the light, but rather, the light mixes with the other lights that are hitting that surface. So it's a mix of these colors. In blend mode terms, so you instead multiply the destination color by 1, so you basically keep the previous color and add IQ and fun on top using alpha. But this has a huge limitation. See, drawing the light on a surface with additive blending only adds the new light, and it acts like the surface is already lit. This also means that we can't make anything darker or add shadows or add ambient lighting. But there is a solution. In fact, it solves multiple problems, like at least two. And that is by using the almighty multiply blend mode. The multiply blend mode lets us make things darker, which means we might get lost. So we're gonna need a map, a light map. You may have heard about how some games have something called baked lighting. This is the process of calculating the lighting beforehand and creating a new image that is basically a map of the lights, or a light map. Imagine there is this column with a shadow. If neither the column nor the light is gonna move, then we can just put the shadow into the floor texture. That's basically how light maps work. And generating these light maps are actually really simple. Well, at least in concept. Let's look at one of the most exciting examples for this topic. A brick wall. First, we have the wall itself with the texture and no lights. Then, we create this new texture that is pure black. Instead of drawing the lights on the wall, we draw them on this new black texture. This is where you need to use additive blend mode, as that's how light mixes. So now, areas with no light are black and areas with light have the color of the light. In 3D games, light maps are generated for each surface and act like a secondary texture. 2D games can also do this, but instead creating a light map for the entire screen. I'm not sure if it's still called light maps at that point, but it behaves basically the same. But either way, you have a base and a light map. How do you apply it? Drawing it additively could work for this, sort of, but there's no darkness and the lights are too bright. And that's why we need to use the almighty multiply blend mode. You simply take the base texture and multiply it by the light map. Yes, you multiply two images. So areas with no light are multiplied by 0, and areas with light keep the color of the light. Here's how that would look as a formula. It's a little cheeky, you multiply the destination color by 0 and multiply the source by the destination color, or vice versa. That's what's called baking, by the way. You create or bake these light maps beforehand so they don't have to be calculated every time you need it. There are other blend modes like these ones, but they're generally used for more artistic purposes. Oh, and blend modes are actually quite different from shaders, even though they seem similar. You can actually use both, like I did in my Pentomino Tetris game Pentis. I wanted to create this expanding outline effect around the pieces, so I did that by drawing these squares around the tiles additively. This meant that when the red and white collided, it would be white, otherwise they would stay the same. Then I applied a shader which turned the white parts invisible and turned the red into any color I wanted. My point is, blend modes can be used in really cool ways, but you'll probably just use them for light effects. Well, now you can.